So far, we have seen approximation algorithms that delivered a 2 approximation or a 1.5 approximation or something like that. But what if I would tell you that we can get sometimes for some problems something much more powerful? So imagine you can tell me how good of an approximation you need. So you will tell me I need a solution that is within 10% of the optimum solution. And then I give you an algorithm that delivers that. And then the next day you say, actually, I need something that is within 1% of the optimal solution. And I can immediately give you an algorithm that achieves that. And then maybe you say, actually, I need something within 0.1% of the optimal solution. And again, I can immediately give you an algorithm that gives you that. For whatever approximation you require, I can deliver an algorithm that achieves that. Too good to be true? No, sometimes this is actually possible. The only caveat here is that the running time of these algorithms will increase as you request better and better approximations. Now, for any fixed approximation, the running time will still be polynomial in the size of the input. But the polynomial function that describes the running time will get bigger and bigger. The exponents will be larger and larger, for example. So there's a certain trade-off between running time and the quality of the approximation you get. And if you request an approximation that is kind of too small, too close to one, too close to the optimum, then in that scenario, in practice, it might not be really feasible anymore to run this algorithm, although theoretically it's still an efficient approximation algorithm. A result like this is called a polynomial-time approximation scheme. So technically, a polynomial-time approximation scheme is not a single algorithm. It's a family of algorithms that for any positive constant epsilon, there is an algorithm in this family such that that algorithm produces a 1 plus epsilon approximation. Well-known examples of problems where such a result is possible is load balancing and the Euclidean traveling salesperson problem. As I said, the running time can depend on the approximation guarantee you require. In particular, if we require an approximation guarantee of 1 plus epsilon, the running time will depend on the size of the input, n, as well as on 1 over epsilon. In a polynomial time approximation scheme, we require the running time to be polynomial in the input size n, but we do not necessarily require it to be polynomial in 1 over epsilon as well. So for example, if you have a running time of n to the power of 1 over epsilon, that would be a valid running time for a polynomial time approximation scheme. In this case, the running time is polynomial in n, but it is exponential in 1 over epsilon, because 1 over epsilon is in the exponent of the function. If you need a result that is guaranteed to be within 1% of the optimal solution, in this case you have to choose epsilon to be equal to 0.01. And then this gives you an algorithm that has a running time, if you just plug this in, of n to the power of 100. So that's a very large polynomial. So the running time is polynomial in n, but if epsilon is too small, it might not be very practical anymore. For this reason, we sometimes hope for something better than a PTAS. And this better thing is called a fully polynomial time approximation scheme, or FPTAS. An FPTAS is just the same as a PTAS. The only difference is that now we require that the running time is not just polynomial in the size of the input n, but also polynomial in 1 over epsilon. An example of a running time for an FPTAS would be something of the form n cubed divided by epsilon squared. This is just an example, but you can see that in this case, if we would require a 1% approximation, we would again set epsilon to 0.01, and if you plug that in, that function becomes 10,000 times n cubed. Now 10,000 is not a small number, but as you can see, the exponent in this function is not very large, so it scales much better than what we had in the case of a p-test. Make sure you understand what a p-test is and what an fp-test is, and in particular what the difference between the two is.